The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron.
Hello and welcome to the Big Scottish Football Podcast. I'm Stephen Mill. This is Ewen Cameron beside me. I hope he's had a decent weekend. We'll get stuck into that in just a wee second. But listen, thank you very much for all your feedback on last week's show. We love it when you get in touch at Big Football Scott on Twitter. I'm at Stephen Mill. He's Ewen D. Cameron on Twitter as well. And of course, on YouTube, you can leave your comments there. And we love reading them every single week. Good or bad, we always take the feedback. It's brilliant that you all get in touch and feel so passionate about certain things on the show. Now, Ewen. Now, obviously, we're going to get to the football in just a wee second, but I can tell by your face that you're maybe not in the best mood. Now, I put a wee video up just 10 minutes ago before we started recording, and I was just saying, oh, good morning, Ewan, are you ready for the podcast? And then you just got up and walked out. So, first of all, I'm glad to see that you're back. I'm glad to see that you've got your wee pouch for your iPad, which is great. I love your wee pouch. It's fantastic. It's really handy for putting your wee iPad in.
Producer John?
Mm-hmm.
What? I'm speaking to Producer John, not you.
Yes, right. Ewan.
See the tone that I'm having to put up with here.
What tone?
His tone.
What's my tone?
His sarcastic tone. Right?
John, did you pick up any sarcasm?
I didn't.
No?
I didn't. Just thought you were speaking normal.
And by the way,
we're Ewan, a couple of minutes in and Ewan, your voice is already grating on me.
Now, Ewan, the thing is, right, I know Hearts have had a bad start to the season. And I'm not, listen, so have Dunfermline. Dunfermline have had a terrible start to the season. They've not scored a goal yet.
Yeah, but Stephen, did you say you were title challengers?
No, and that's what I was actually going to mention. Yeah. So I didn't think Dunfermline would have a particularly good season.
And you're not...
Now, it's still worse than what I thought it would be.
And here's the thing though, Stephen.
But whereas, like, Hearts are having a terrible season.
Yeah, okay.
And you said that they would... Was it split the old firm, you said?
Uh-huh.
And put a title challenge so in?
There's a slight difference to you and I when you say that Dunfermline are not going to have a great season, and you were correct in that because you started off abysmally.
Yeah.
I turned around and said after the Rangers game that we would split the old firm.
When you won 0-0 against Rangers, of course, yeah. Who can forget?
See, John.
Ewan.
Did you hear that?
What?
I just said...
When you win 0-0 again, what's the sarcasm?
You won 0-0 against Rangers.
Listen, I said that Hearts would split the old firm.
Yeah.
Not only did and I you, say...
No,
not
but,
only
did well, I say listen, that Ewan, there's a long way to go.
Yeah.
There's only three or four games into the season.
Yeah.
What I would say is, have you had time to reassess that? And are you still sticking with Hearts are going to... split the old firm. Bearing in mind that Aberdeen have now won all of their matches this season, and they play Ross County on Saturday and could be 3 points clear at the top of the league going into the game Celtic Rangers on Sunday. Because they would, for me, that would be them in a better position than Hearts.
As it stands right now, Stephen Naismith is making me look like a fanny. I'm angry. And I'm upset and I'm annoyed.
I don't think Stephen Naismith is doing that. I think it might be
well,
a wee bit closer to home.
Well, whatever. Doesn't matter.
Anyway, we'll get to the football. We'll get stuck into the football.
John, I'm not even getting an opportunity.
You will get an opportunity.
To answer any of the questions any of the points that he is making.
No, I'm not.
We'll get to the football.
Just
so why have you started the show talking about football?
Because you were all grumpy.
Yeah, but because I've not... Right, do you want me to give you the truth?
Grumpy Jambo Bear.
I'm going to give you the truth, right? So, yesterday was horrific, right?
I was worried yesterday.
I went off the grid.
You went off the... Because usually you're, you know, putting stuff in the group chat and...
I'm on Twitter.
You're on Twitter, chatting away.
I was off the grid.
And all the rest of it. Now...
I was off the grid and
Was it connected to the Hearts result yesterday that you went off
yes.
the grid? Right, fair enough, right?
It was.
I did suspect that.
I was scared I was going to tweet something I'd later regret. I was so angry and upset that I gave myself a headache.
Yeah.
And I was in my bed early last night. That's why I could see. Look, I'll even show you. Where's my phone? I'll even show you.
Did people get in contact with you? Like after mother...
Did people get in contact with me?
Well, what do you
what
mean?
What question is that?
Well, I thought that maybe some people
look
would
at
say...
That. All those messages, I've not looked at them.
Yeah, there's quite a lot of messages there.
Yeah, I've not even looked at them.
Right.
I've not even opened up the messages on WhatsApp.
So, right, before we get to that...
Filled with fannies messaging me. I'm not going to reply to any of your messages.
Some people would like messages filled with fannies. I thought you would be a fan of that. Right, like before we get to the football, and I will get your thoughts on it. Obviously, you'll be allowed to.
Can we talk about the weekend?
I was just going to ask you about your weekend in general.
Okay, the weekend in general was okay. I didn't have the best of weekends, but also didn't have a really bad weekend. It was all right. The best thing about the weekend was the news that was breaking all weekend that Noel and Liam Gallagher appear to have patched things up. Yeah. And tomorrow at 8 a.m, that's Tuesday at 8 a.m, they're going to announce that Oasis are getting back together again.
So or they're going to announce a re-release of Definitely Maybe.
Or tracks a that have yet to be released.
That would be funny. I think that would be quite funny. Now listen, I'm a fan of Oasis. I think they're great.
All right, same.
But I think it could be the mother of all trolls. Which would be, I mean, it would be hilarious. I would find it hilarious anyway.
We're releasing our greatest hits album in time for the Christmas.
Exactly. We're releasing a calendar.
That was really good news. I was happy to hear that. And the news is that they're going to have 10 nights at Wembley, 10 nights at Heaton Park in Manchester, and tickets should go on sale or should be announced at some point tomorrow just after 8 a.m. So that was really good news over the weekend. Can I have my movie thing? Do the thing?
The movie thing.
John.
Get the movie thing, John.
Got a recommendation to make. Got we recommend.
Oh, by the way, somebody said last week actually that they enjoyed your review. Can't remember who it was. I can't remember what your review was.
American Murder, Lisa Peterson. There's a few people that like that. This is a movie recommendation.
It's a film.
Deadpool and Wolverine.
Yeah, is it not like number one at the box office?
Yeah, but I went to see it.
All right, okay.
I went to see it with the kids. It's the best Deadpool movie out of the three.
Okay.
Highly recommend it.
I've only seen the first one.
First one's great. Second one, avoid. You don't need to see the second one.
Okay.
Doesn't have any connection to the third one, so you can see the third one out with seeing the second one. But I'm not the biggest fan of DC or Marvel. I can watch the odd movie here and there, but my kids wanted to see Deadpool and Wolverine. Went along to see it. A lot of great action. It was quite gory.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of blood. I wouldn't take the mother-in-law, although we did.
Does she not like blood?
Well, we did.
Right,
we
took her. You took her to traumatise her, yeah.
Yes, and she was traumatised. But I would highly recommend it. I'm not going to say much more than that. Great action sequences, lots of blood and gore.
Is Hugh Jackman in it?
Hugh Jackman's in it. Do you know who else is in it?
Ryan Reynolds.
No. Somebody we know. Somebody we're pals with.
Is Ryan Reynolds not in it?
He is in it.
Well,
he's not our pal. Somebody that lives in Scotland is in the movie.
Somebody that lives in Scotland, are they Scottish?
Yeah, they're Scottish.
And they're in the film.
Famous Scottish person who's our pal.
Our pal?
Our pal.
Steve Cowan, former Aberdeen and Hibs striker.
No.
Pat Harvey.
TV sitcom.
It's Greg Hempel.
Greg Hempel?
Yeah, it's Greg Hempel, yes.
Who plays the part of Victor.
Yes. Is he a barman?
He's a barman.
Yeah, I thought that. Did he not appear in the trailer?
He's in the trailer as well, yeah. So it's lovely seeing Greg on the big screen. So yeah, go and see Deadpool and Wolverine. That is a fantastic movie. A lot of blood and glory if you like that.
Okay, lots of feedback on last week's show. A lot on Ewan's behaviour, actually.
Which is behaviour?
Super Diesel says, 5 minutes in and the toys are out the pram. If you dish it out, you have to be able to take it back.
I do take it.
What's happened to the hearts gear? Haven't seen the top, the hat, the scarf, the happy dance, etc.
There's been nothing to dance about.
Alan says, my two-year-old daughter has less meltdowns than Ewan, plus she would answer more questions right in the quiz.
Maybe we should get your daughter in here to play the quiz.
Derek, think Ewan had his period this week. It's a bit grim. Aldo says, Ewan, what a man, wears his heart on his sleeve and just comes out and speaks his mind. You have to applaud that. However, I've watched the meltdown speech twice and near wet myself. Best Scottish football podcast out there. Thank you, Aldo.
Here's the thing with me.
Graham says, Ewan's football opinion is as brutal as his dress sense. It's three games in and he wants Nasey gone. Utter garbage. Nasey has done a cracking job and things can change very quickly, like it did last season when we went 12 unbeaten. Even the best managers in the world make mistakes, but they learn from them, as will Nasey. Cameron says, Ewan Cameron with his grey hair looks like George Clooney through Timu. quite some feedback on producer John as well.
His antics last week.
John, if you're there as well. The Celtic way, don't know if that's the real name. The fact that producer John sounded like a 14-year-old but looks like a 47-year-old divorcee is wild.
43 and still married, thanks very much.
Yeah, exactly. But by the time you're 47, who knows? Who knows? Jock says, whatever happened to the Father Ted quiz?
It's a good question, isn't it?
What happened to the Father Ted quiz? You were meant to watch Father Ted.
I've not watched it yet, that's why.
And the review of the week is from Mark. Stephen should start every show opening a packet of crisps just to watch Ewan's PTSD kick in from his camping nights. Because you mentioned that, remember the crisps with the... Aye. The stuff in the...
My pal next to me using an empty packet of crisps for a jolly time. Would you call it a jolly time?
Probably.
Do you feel joy?
I wouldn't say jolly would be the first thing that I feel.
After it's done, would you not just go, oh, that was jolly?
No, I wouldn't.
What word would you use? After you've used a crisp packet and you're...
If I'd used I'd be like, for God's sake, what have I done?
Would you feel guilt?
Probably, yeah.
And every time you smell cheese and onion, it'd remind you of that moment.
Great times. Right, let's move on to Scottish teams in Europe, because two big ties coming up this week. Thursday night there, Hearts did pretty well, actually. Victoria Pilsen, I mean, they lost obviously a very, very late goal, which was disappointing, but they didn't look great. Hearts will obviously have to up their game. I'm not trying to bait you here, but they'll have to up their game on Thursday. They've got a chance at Tynecastle, I think, and Kilmarnock looked like they were playing so well. Obviously the penalty happens.
Wasn't it a penalty either?
Derek McInnes was furious after the game.
It's not a penalty.
And then obviously again they lose a goal in the 96th minute, but early goal at Rugby Park and it's all back on.
Cup final, if they can get the first goal, you never know. As for Hearts, I don't want us dropping into the Europa League. I really don't. Dropping into Europa League. I just can't face it.
What? So you'd rather play against Diddy teams than
play
against...
In the Conference League, yeah.
Isn't that a bit pathetic?
Pot one. If Hearts go into the Europa League, if they beat Pilsen on Thursday night, we will face Roma, Man United, Porto.
Roma got beat by Empoli last night.
Ajax, Eintracht Frankfurt, Lazio or Spurs. That's who we're going to face. One of those teams.
Oh, that sounds terrible. Imagine playing all these big, amazing teams and going to Rome and playing in Frankfurt and Manchester United.
You don't win money for getting hammered left, right and centre in Europe. But if you're in the Europa Conference League...
I don't know if you're familiar with Celtic's Champions League record over the last few years.
But you get more money for wins and draws.
You do.
And Hearts have got a better chance of getting wins and draws in Europa Conference League.
Celtic have won one Champions League match in the last 12.
Yeah, but they get a pot of money to be there in the first place.
And you get a pot of money for being in the Europa League.
But you get more money for more points that you win. And Scotland's coefficient, great Twitter page, highly recommend everyone go and check out Scotland's coefficient. He's already done the maths on it. So say Hearts drop in or fall into the Europa League, and we win none of our games, and we drop into Europa Conference League and we win two games, we'll make just as much money in the Conference League as we do in the Europa League. So I would rather go into the Conference League, have a chance of qualifying and getting in the knockout stages and being competitive, than going into the Europa League and getting absolutely obliterated, which then dents our confidence going forward. Our confidence is already diabolical.
Wee team mentality you've got here.
Spurs at Tynecastle with our best 11.
It's a pre-season friendly.
Their kids hammered us 5 going on 10-1.
Hearts went down to Liverpool, 10 years ago or whenever it was.
David Templeton scored.
Exactly. Got a draw down at Anfield. Drew at White Hart Lane against Spurs in the Europa League.
But we've got beat 5-0 up here.
Right, okay, so it's doable. I'm not saying that you're capable of not getting hammered.
I was at that game against Spurs when they came up here and it was embarrassing. And then Spurs were in second gear at White Hart Lane. I don't want to be in the Europa League.
Yeah, it's a really wee team mentality.
Why
would you want to play the best teams? That'd be rubbish.
If you win, you'll be happy. But then reality will sink in and you'll go, oh my God, what have we actually done? Is that me or you?
It's not me. It's clearly you. Put your phone on silent, please.
I would like, if we were to draw 2-2 in an exciting game and just crash out with a slim margin of 3-2, I wouldn't be greeting, put it that way. If we get hammered 4-0 or something, then I won't be a happy bunny. But if we put a game into it and we go out on whatever aggregate score 3-2, then I'm happy to accept that.
It's quite.
It's not. It's not. I'm looking.
It's loser mentality.
It's about being realistic. It's like Scotland just now. We're in pot one for the Nations League, and we've got Croatia, Portugal, and Poland. And I know we're going to get hammered up and down Europe, and it's just not good. And then it's going to put Stevie Clark under pressure.
I don't think, like, Portugal, fair enough. But, like, Poland aren't great.
But going away from home against these teams, we're not good enough away from home.
Scotland played Poland in a European Championship qualifying section, and we drew 2-2 with them in Poland.
We'll see. But I'm just saying.
We also have an absolutely ridiculous record against Croatia. I think one of the times they beat us was at the Euros.
I just think that Hearts are not ready for that step up to play your Man United's, Romas, and Portos of this world. I just think we're not there. And pot two is just as bad as pot one.
So you're saying that, like, so far from what you've seen this season, from Hearts domestically, you're a bit worried if they were going to play like a big team in Europe, since they can't beat, you know, Motherwell.
Yeah, that's fair enough. That's the short and long of it.
Cool. Right. That's fine then.
Kilmarnock, well done to them so far to get in that position where they're 90 minutes away from possibly going into the Europa Conference League is brilliant. So well done to them. I don't see them doing it, but as you say, you get the first goal at full rugby park under the floodlights, you never know.
Okay, let's do some transfers then, producer John, shall we? So I need the music for that though, and we need someone else actually.
Where is he? Is he there?
How you doing? Yep, it's here. He's here. It's Jim. How you doing? I'm here only for the next couple of weeks. You'll be glad to hear about it. So what we got this morning on the transfer talk, the window is creaking closer to being closed.
Matt O'Reilly's gone.
Matt O'Reilly's away down to Brighton. He was on an EasyJet flight.
Yeah, you see the pictures of him in the EasyJet flight.
He was on the EasyJet flight. Quite interesting they didn't book the front seats. He was halfway back the plane. You know, nightmare with the luggage.
But you think Brighton, who have just spent 30 million on a player, would get a wee private plane for him?
Not very good for the environment, Ewan. Brighton, very green. They've got a green MP. That's what it'll be. They've literally got a green MP.
Napoli have agreed a fee in the region of 30 million
30
euros.
Million for Scott McTominay.
Scott McTominay.
Wow, what days we're living in. What days we are living in. Fantastic. Scott McTominay.
They're still trying to sign Brighton's Billy Gilmore.
Billy Gilmore, and it's only about 8 million or something.
12.
Well, what's going on there?
12 million.
I don't know what's going on there, who Scott McTominay's agent is or who's getting the money.
So it's close to 40 million at Napoli are spending on two Scotland midfielders.
Two Scotland midfielders. That'll be great. And Napoli, of course, remember, folks, is in Italy.
Celtic are closing on the loan of a Barcelona signing, left back Alex Valle.
Yeah, of course, yeah, from the Valleys, a Welsh guy. Great to have him on board.
1.3 million signing on fee for him, a loan deal for 1.3 million pounds.
Fantastic. I mean, that means that once they've sold everyone, that means they're still making lots of money. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so there we are. Did you see the folks shouting at Pierre Lowell yesterday?
I did. Did you see that?
I saw that as well. What did you think of that, Ewan?
Well, they want them to start reinvesting some of the money they've spent.
That's what they were saying.
They want them to spend some of the money that they have. Not invested. What's the word? They want to
use your words, Ewan. Come on, remember.
They want them to
sound it out. Sound it out if you don't know what it is.
The money
they've accumulated over the years.
That's it.
That's why I'm here. Don't worry about it. That's my friend, is journalism.
They might be spending some of that money that they've accumulated over the years. There are reports this morning that they're going to be spending around £7 million on Arne Engels from Augsburg in Germany. He's a 20-year-old midfielder. Highly sought after.
He's wearing his socks, and it's fantastic.
Yeah, Arne
Brilliant.
Engels, valued at around 9 million, but apparently Celtic have put in a bid of around 6.5 to 7 million pounds for the midfielder. A replacement to Matt O'Reilly.
Matt O'Reilly, because he's away to Brighton.
Yeah.
He's green MP.
Brazilian midfielder legend Ronaldinho's son, João Mendes, could be sent on loan to Dundee.
Ronaldinho's son's coming to Dundee.
To Dundee.
Hopefully, Ronaldinho comes over and experiences Fat Sam's. What a place. Fantastic.
He's at Burnley, and he might be coming to Dundee.
Fantastic. Some Samba skills on display at Dens. You love to see it. And remember, Burnley is in England.
You ever been to Burnley?
Yeah. No.
Been to Dundee, though?
Yeah.
And?
Well.
It's good enough. Would that be your review of Dundee? Well.
It's a place. I'll give you that.
One final bit of transfer news for you. Window's still open until Friday.
It's still creaking closed.
Yeah, we've heard that. Jesus Christ, your voice.
Creaking closed. In fact, it's not Friday, is it? Is it Friday?
It is Friday, yeah, 29th. It's Friday, isn't it? The transfer window closes on Friday.
It's not closed on the 31st, which is Saturday.
Closed on Friday.
Friday? Yeah, unbelievable.
Well, 11 o'clock at night.
That's past my bedtime, Ewen.
Aye, Ewen. It's not going to be in the morning, is it?
That's why he's no longer on Sky Sports News, because he's got to get his bed. Birmingham City have made their 13th summer transfer window signing by bringing
13? That's more than 11.
Centre-back Ben Davis on a seasons-long loan from Rangers.
I saw that.
And Dunfermline have signed Tommy Fogarty from Birmingham.
I saw that. Cracking signing for the black and white, the Pars. Hopefully firing us up to 8th in the league or something.
He's a defender.
Yes.
What position?
Centre half.
Do you need a centre half?
We need fucking everything at this moment in time, so... Welcome aboard, Tommy boy. Right, okay, let's move on to the football then in the Premiership. We'll start on Saturday, shall we? We'll start with Dundee United's win against St Johnstone. Good start to the season for Dundee United. St Johnstone, obviously, again, okay start to the season. Loss, win, loss. Dundee United, a couple of draws and their first win at Tannadice. 7 without defeat as well for Dundee United. And, good start for Jim Goodwin.
Dundee United get the win. But I thought St Johnstone were really unlucky to lose that game.
Yeah, I thought St Johnstone did all right as well, to be honest.
They create some really good chances at 0-0.
St Johnstone have been better than what I thought
they were going forward.
So, obviously, CDB getting sent off, we'll get to that in VRWF. But I thought they did all right against Rangers last week. Mm-hmm. They obviously beat Kilmarnock.
That's right.
They weren't great against Aberdeen on the Monday night, I don't think.
No, they weren't.
But I did think at the weekend, and obviously the miss of the season as well, unbelievable.
That was at 0-0.
Exactly.
4 yards out.
And, you know, he scores that and it's a different game.
Very much so. I thought St Johnstone were very good at Tannadice. I think they deserved at least a draw from it. As you say, we'll get to sending off shortly. But fair play to Dundee United. They're unbeaten. 2 draws and a victory. I thought they possibly deserved... What was the game they drew that they were leading right up? Against Ross County?
Ross County. I thought they were...
What I mean is when you're 1-0 up and you're going into the 96th minute, you really should hold on and win that game, despite Ross County being the better team on the day. So they'll kind of be kicking themselves that they don't have more points after leading for so long against Ross County. So well done to Jim Goodwin and Dundee United. And they've carried a wee bit of luck against St Johnstone and against Ross County. But in any football match, even the top managers will tell you, you need a bit of luck to go with your skill and your application. So, yeah, I'm happy for Dundee United. I'm happy for Jim Goodwin because he's had a lot of stick over the years from us. We've given him a bit of stick after what happened at Aberdeen and then Hibs. So well done to Jim Goodwin. It looks as though you might be proving some people wrong.
Hibs, let's get on to them. We are going to be joined later on in the podcast by Hibs supporters, so we'll get stuck into Hibs.
Oh, that'll cheer me up. Thank God there's something
in a wee bit more depth a wee bit later on. But in terms of the game on Saturday, cracking game again. Hibs 2, Dundee 2, probably a fair result in the end. Boyle and Bowie for Hibs and Tiffany and Murray for Dundee. 31 goals in 8 games so far this season for Dundee. Simon Murray's going to be a terrific signing, I think. I do like Tiffany. Can they keep on to Luke McEwen, though?
Celtic are sniffing about. I keep reading about that. I know Hibs are still not giving up.
Would that be a good move for him?
Going to Celtic? No. Because I don't think he gets in that team. Who's he getting ahead of? Well, McGregor's in there, Bernardo's there, and Hatate.
I know, but, O'Reilly's left now. So, you know, Celtic will be playing a lot of games this season.
But Bernardo would have been on the bench if O'Reilly was playing yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
But Bernardo's ahead of McGowan.
So if you're Luke McEwen, you're not going to Celtic?
He's going places, that boy, and I think going to Celtic will take him back because I don't think he'll get as much game time. Is he going to play ahead of Bernardo in Europe in the Champions League? I doubt it. He might come on and play his part, but will he be a regular starter? I just don't see it. I think Celtic's midfield looked brilliant yesterday. Mm-hmm. It's like the, like O'Reilly was there, but he's not. Thought Bernardo was very good yesterday. Hatate was very good. I know we're not talking about Celtic just now, but I'm just in regards to the Dundee midfielder. I think he'd be making a mistake going to Hibs as well, because I think they're just in an absolute mess. Stay where you are for at least another season. You might find that other clubs will come in for you. There could be an Aberdeen sniffing about, could be a Hart sniffing about. I know there's chat.
The Championship down south, maybe.
As I'm saying, the Championship as well down south. So I think that boy's got a massive future, but so's the boy Cameron in midfielder. He scored a goal that was chopped
Silla
off.
Silla as well.
Silla, those three are brilliant in midfield. But I think that McCowan should stay where he is for at least one more season.
Honking defending from Hibs for both of their goals. Like, poor. So poor. But it seems like Hibs have not been able to defend properly since, I don't know, Jack Ross was in charge when they finished third, maybe? You know, you're going back like 4 years now. That's clearly where the problems are, and they don't seem to be able to fix it. Going forward, they do offer threats. Decent free kick from Martin Boyle. Kieran Bowie looks like he's a find, obviously.
I like Bowie. I'm jealous that Hibs have signed Bowie. He looks good.
I say a find. Obviously, we knew who he was before, but it looks like
he's good.
He does look good. He's sort of like hustled and bustled his way through. Crack and finish for an angle as well. He looks like he's going to be a bright spot for Hibs this season.
And also, good news for Scotland, for the national team. There's something about him that I really like. When he came on against Celtic, he caused them problems, hit the crossbar, was lucky not to score, unlucky not to score. Strong, physical, holds the ball up well, brushes defenders aside, knows his way to goal. And I know he came on as a substitute yesterday, and he came on as a substitute against Celtic as well. But I think once that boy gets up to pace, I think Hibs have got a really good player in Kieran Bowie.
Yeah.
And I think that Scotland got a potential number nine going forward. That's how much I rate him. Just watching the flashes that I've seen, there's something there. And I hope Hibs are able to get the best out of him.
So we'll speak more about Hibs a wee bit later on in the podcast. But 2-2 between them and Dundee. The other game on Saturday was Rangers 6, Ross County 0. An absolute stroll for Rangers at the National Stadium. It is Rangers' best result in exactly 6 months, when they beat Hearts 5-0. Cyriel Dessers has 12 goals in his last 16 Premiership starts, and it was so straightforward on Saturday. You know, it was barely a test for Rangers because Ross County were so poor.
It was a training game for them.
And Rangers played well, obviously. Matondo getting a couple of goals as well.
Will he be
Lawrence,
there?
Danilo.
Will Matondo be there for the Old Firm game on Sunday?
Well, he's sort of known. He didn't really say either way, did he?
Nah, but I know there's interest in him from down south, particularly with Leeds, etc., sniffing about. Listen, if Rangers were to hand pick a game before playing Celtic, as a wee pick me up, you'd have probably said, yeah, let's play Ross County or Hearts, because that's how bad we are right now. But they get Ross County, and it was 6 going on 12. Some of the football was, they were better in the second half. I thought the first half there, they were okay, but the second half, they really picked it up. I thought Matondo was a threat all afternoon. Dessers, you've said it before about he scores the goals, but he also misses a lot of chances as well. Still don't see him getting anything at Parkhead on Sunday. But it'll give them confidence going into that game. But I don't think you can read too much into Rangers winning 6-0, if I'm being honest, because Ross County are not a very good side. I mean, Spartans beat them the week before.
Mm-hmm.
But I think Rangers needed that. I don't think it'll be enough for them to get anything on Sunday.
So, obviously, massive game on Sunday, Celtic versus Rangers. We'll get to the Celtic point of view in just a wee second, but in terms of Rangers, you know, as you say, that is a wee pick-me-up.
Definitely pick-me-up. They needed that. Listen, I've said it all along. I think Rangers have got some really decent players in there. I do love Diamande, and I've said that a few times. I think he's one of those players that Rangers will probably be able to sell for big money in a year or two's time. I think he's that good a player. Matondo, for me, there's a player in there, but he's so inconsistent that you can't rely on him. I think Dessers is a decent striker, but I've said it before, you'll not win a title with Dessers. Yeah, I know he's scored in the goals and he's scored a number of goals, but when you're scoring the goals, when you're winning comfortably, is all well and good. But it's when you don't score the goals when
he's not scored against Celtic yet.
Yeah, and when you're missing the chances you miss against Ross County, when you're 1-0 up, when you're chasing a league title, that's when it really matters. When you're scoring a couple of goals in a 5-0 win, great, it looks great because you've scored X amount of goals in X amount of games. But see, when it comes, push comes to shove, when you need to score that goal to win a game or to close a game out, he's not doing that.
So what do Rangers need to do on Sunday to win?
Get a Parks of Hamilton bus and stick it in front of the goal.
Right. So you think, like, the way Celtic are playing...
Celtic has been sensational this season so far. I mean, at some point they're going to hit a bump in the road.
And that might be Sunday?
It could be. I mean, a derby game, you never know. I mean, Rangers have been pretty competitive in the games against Celtic. And Clement's already said, we're going to have a go. We're not going to park the bus. We're going to have a go and we're going to attack Celtic.
So cancel the phone call to Parks of Hamilton.
Well, they still might decide to do that.
Right.
Put it this way, I don't think Celtic will hammer them. I think Rangers will score, but I could see Celtic winning at something like 3-1.
Okay.
But I think it'll be a really good game, and I do think the Rangers will have a go. It'll be interesting to see what happens if Rangers take the lead, because it's going to be at Parkhead with no Rangers fans, and how the Celtic fans might react to that. I think for Rangers to get anything out of that game or to have any chance, they have to score first. Because see if Celtic score early, and that's what they've been doing recently. They've been coming out the blocks at 150 miles an hour and nobody can live with them. They're blowing teams away. If Rangers can withstand that quick start from Celtic in the first 15 minutes and then they get the first goal, then we've got a game on our hands, because then the Celtic fans are on the case of, Brendan Rodgers and the team. So it'll be an intriguing game, but Celtic score first, I'd fear for Rangers.
Straightforward for Celtic yesterday as well against St Mirren. As Ewen was saying there, McGregor scoring after, 3 minutes or whatever it was. Hitati and then Johnson rounding it off.
I nearly turned the telly off when McGregor scored.
I went out for lunch. I only saw the first half.
Nothing against Celtic, right? Nothing against Celtic or Brendan Rodgers. But when they score, you know the inevitable is going to happen. And it's a boring game. It's a bit like watching Manchester City play Ipswich or Brentford or Nottingham Forest, because you know what the outcome's going to be. You know exactly what's going to happen. Now, 9 times out of 10, you might get the odd game here and... No, not even that. I mean, what am I saying? That's just a load of pish. Celtic are just too good. They're a league above everybody else. They shouldn't be in our league. They are... top end championship, bottom end premiership team. That's how good they are. They're not a top 10 team in the Premier League, but they're bottom end. Do you know what I'm getting there? That's the kind of team that they are.
Yeah.
I think they're a really good side. Great football, quick, incisive, keep possession, but it's really quick. It's really good on the eye and it's boring to watch because nobody can get near them. They can't touch them, a bit like Man City. So I think Celtic, as good as they are also boring to watch, if that makes sense.
You think they're boring?
Not them. The games are boring because they're that good.
Right, okay.
That's my point. I can't watch Man City games. You're the same. Can you watch Man City games?
No, I'm not interested.
Exactly, neither am I, because you just know. You just know. Now, our ears pricked up when Ipswich scored on Saturday. We went, oh, that might be a game then. And then it was 1-0 to Ipswich on 7 minutes. On the 17th minute, it was 3-1.
Yeah. Celtic are obviously just leagues apart from everyone else.
And, you know, sometimes that St Mirren game can be tricky. Celtic have noticed in the past.
St Mirren beat Celtic under Ange.
I know, and that's my point. It can be a tricky game, but yesterday...
They were just operating at a different level. Yeah. And by the way, what I should say, they should be, because they have so much more money than everyone else.
Yeah.
Their squad, they can afford to go out and buy a striker for £9.5 million.
And they're talking about signing that midfielder from Germany for £7 million.
Yeah, of course, they've sold O'Reilly. And mm-hmm. I'm not saying that it's not
sustainable.
But they've
already spent how much for Bernardo? They've already signed him as well. Yeah, like 4 million?
4 or 5 million. Yeah. Again...
You're right. I mean, they're operating at a different level. And asking St Mirren or any other club to put in any sort of challenge is asking a lot.
If any other team beat Celtic this season, apart from Rangers, you know, we're talking...
That'd be a shock.
It's a shock.
It's a shock.
And, you know, if you're talking teams like, you know, St Mirren or Motherwell or St Johnson, if they beat Celtic, we're talking miracle stuff here. That shouldn't happen.
Even if they get a draw, we'd be sitting here go, shock at the weekend, Celtic have drawn 0-0 with St Johnston.
Because Celtic are so much better, and so they should be, given what they're spending compared to everyone
else. I just
wish
they would just go away.
Right.
Would you not like to see Rangers and Celtic in the Premier League? Would you not like to see that? I mean, I'd love to see it. And the reason they'll never get invited, because the clubs know that Rangers and Celtic, after 2 or 3 years in the Premier League, with that money that they get from the TV rights, would be battling for top four, and they're scared of Celtic and Rangers.
Yeah, but that's why it's not going to happen. Aberdeen 2, Kilmarnock 0. So we'll get to the sending off in VRWTF. Only two changes for Kilmarnock for Thursday night. Wright and Vassell dropping out. 8 wins from 8 for the Dandy Dons. Ewen Cameron, you are cacking your pants because Aberdeen, yeah, they've had a decent run in terms of their fixtures and stuff, and they've still got another couple of decent fixtures coming up, but you can only beat what's in front of you, and that's 8 wins from 8. You can't really complain about that.
If you're going to handpick fixtures to start off your managerial career at a new club, you'd be handpicking those fixtures.
Yep.
And yes, you can only beat what's in front of you. So congratulations to Aberdeen and the new manager. 8 wins out of 8. They've got 9 points out of 9 in the league. They're joint top of the league table with Celtic. I said last week that I now fear Aberdeen could be the team that challenges who I thought were certainties for third and Hearts, and possibly challenging the Old Firm and being up there with Celtic and Rangers. But with Aberdeen not having any European football, as I pointed out last week, I think they could have a really good season.
Also selling Miofsky for lots and lots of money as well. They've brought in Kevin Nisbet from Millwall on loan this season.
Well, you know him better than me because he was at your club, Dunfermline.
He's a goal scorer and he will score goals. I also think his all-round play is good.
He's a good hold-up player.
I think that he's obviously had problems with his fitness. I think he's had problems with his attitude as well, let's be honest.
There's a lot of chat about his attitude. Has he always had that?
Well, I think he fell out with the manager at Millwall. I think at Hibs there was a few issues. There was issues with Dunfermline as well. But, you know, he's obviously a talented boy.
Yeah.
And he knows where the back of the net is. So I think he'll be a decent signing once he gets up to speed. I saw the highlights. He looked a wee bit sort of off the pace. But that's to be expected.
I think it's a really good signing for them. I don't listen, Miofsky's a completely different striker to Kevin Nisbet, but it wasn't that long ago when he made the move to Millwall, we were talking about him being the next Scotland striker.
Yeah.
Because he was that
and he was
good.
He was in the squad for the Euros and stuff like
and
that.
He's well thought of. I like Nisbet. I want him to be the striker he can be because, again, it's good for the national team.
Yeah, 100%. Kilmarnock, we've already spoken about. All eyes for them will be on Thursday, and if they can get through that, would obviously be,
I'll be
fantastic.
Amazing.
And Monty that we spoke to last week, the Kilmarnock fan, was saying that, you know, they're quite happy to sacrifice the league stuff just now
to try and get into Europe.
So that's obviously their priority. Final game yesterday. How could I forget? Motherwell 3, Hearts 1. It was Lennon Miller's 18th birthday yesterday. A couple of assists for him. He looks like a player.
They're going to get a lot of money for him.
Yeah, I think Lennon Miller probably by the end of this, probably next summer, I would say, would be
he'll have a queue of people
on a lot of people's shopping list. So Motherwell, cracking win for them, first win of the season. So that's them up to 4 points. Welcome, because I think Stuart Kettlewell was under a wee bit of pressure as well. To be honest with you,
fans weren't happy.
But a good win against another rank rotten performance from Hearts.
Stephen, I've got a celebrity message for you and.
All right,
before
okay.
we go on, if that's okay, I'll
yes,
just play
of course,
that for you.
Yeah,
okay.
Of course, go for that.
So, deep breath. Firstly, are you okay?
A Hollywood idea there.
Oh, that's nice of her. She's put that in. Are you okay, Ewan?
Let me hear that again.
So, deep breath. Firstly, are you okay?
Are you okay, Ewan?
Piss off, Holly.
What do you mean? That's not very nice. So, talk to us. Why are Hearts so shite?
It's a bit disrespectful, is it? No, you're not even a Hearts fan. I'm allowed to say that, but you're no, so wash your mouth out, you prick.
Why are Hearts so shite?
Heart of Midlothian Football Club is funded by the fans.
Yep.
And it's ran by clowns.
Right.
And the biggest clown is in the dugout, and his name is Bozo the Clown.
So not Stephen Naismith, who's the manager.
He's known as Bozo the Clown to me.
To you.
To right, me.
Okay. Just to you.
Nobody. Just to me.
Just to you.
And the two Muppets are next to him, right, said Fred.
Right.
We've become an embarrassment and a joke of a football club. He tinkered again at the weekend. Didn't they know whether we were coming, whether we were going?
You keep saying he needs to do this. He needs to do that.
You went with another back three at the weekend.
He needs to do this. He needs to play that way. Oh, he plays a back four. Oh, yeah, no, actually, that didn't work either. Go back to a back three.
You watched the highlights of that game, and we were disorganised. We were all over the place. It was like watching five-year-olds run around the football pitch, chasing a football. There didn't seem to be any organisation. We didn't know, as I said, whether we were coming, whether we were going. And see, when Stephen O'Donnell scores against you, you know you've got a problem. That's nothing against Stephen O'Donnell.
It's a bit harsh. It's a bit disrespectful.
I like Stephen O'Donnell.
It's quite disrespectful, though, what you've just said there.
What I'm getting at is a defender scoring against you. That's my point.
So and lots of defenders score.
And our overall play so, was...
Would you say that overall you were unhappy with the resulting performance?
All of it.
All of it. Right. Okay. Would you say that it's been a poor start to the season?
That's an understatement, Stephen.
Right. Okay. Would you say that you saying that Hearts were going to split the Old Firm is looking increasingly like a hilarious statement to have made?
Right, I'm going to have to stand by my words.
So despite everything at the start of the season,
I'm going to explain.
You still think that Hearts are going to finish second in the league?
We're only three games in.
So therefore,
wait.
So am I detecting? Correct me if I'm wrong. Am I detecting that you're willing to give Stephen Naismith a wee chance here to turn that around?
No. Here's my point.
Right.
Stephen Naismith should have woken up this morning with a message from the board at Hearts coming for a meeting.
Mm-hmm.
He should have turned up at Tynecastle for that meeting and he should have been given his jotters.
Right, okay. Well, as of this time, he hasn't been.
No, and he probably won't be because the board are shitebags.
Right.
Right. They will make a decision when it's too late, as okay. they have done on numerous occasions. They are quick. They're slow to react, and when they do make a decision, and I think it's inevitable that Naismith will not see out this season, it'll be too late. But if they grow some balls and they do what is right for the football club right now, they could rescue this season. Remember, we're already out of the League Cup, so that chance of winning that trophy is already gone.
Falkirk beat you in that.
That chance is already gone. Right, we're out of that. That's gone.
Yeah,
we are already 8 points behind Aberdeen and Celtic. We are 6 points behind Rangers. Mm-hmm. So it's not insurmountable. It's only the start of the campaign. But with Stephen Naismith as our manager alongside Right Said Fred, we will struggle to get in the top six.
Are you saying that they're deeply dippy at this point? So,
we have... Now, listen...
So, do you think... you're saying it's all in the manager, it's not the players?
All in the manager.
All in the manager.
Clueless.
Like, Shankland's like staggering about the...
He's not staggering about... He's not getting any chances. The players are all over the place. We look so... Like we'd never met each other.
But they have met each other before.
But... It looks like we haven't. It doesn't matter.
I mean, after the first game of the season, when you were celebrating the 0-0 win against Rangers, you like were cock-a-hoop. You were saying, this is our time. And since,
it still can be.
And since then...
It still can be, Stephen.
You've lost to Motherwell.
Falkirk. And Dundee. Correct. Poor. And that's, for me, is a sackable offence.
So Stephen Naismith came out after the game yesterday and said it was poor.
He chucked all the players under the bus, as he always does. Chucked all the players under the bus. Everybody else's fault.
Well, maybe it is their fault.
No, it's not.
Maybe they have to take a look at themselves.
It really isn't. See, at the end of the day, the buck stops with him. And he's now played how many games this season with the League Cup? Four games, four different teams, four different formations, four different systems. At what point do you say, right, this is my best 11, I'm going to stick with it. This is the best formation, I'm going to stick with it. Actually, including the European games, it's five different teams and five games and five formations.
So
The guy is learning on the job. He's got the third best job in Scottish football, and we're allowing an apprentice to learn on the job. And everyone keeps saying to me, but he got you third last year. Well, let's look at last year. Aberdeen were a bomb scare. Hibs were a bomb scare. What did we do ourselves as football fans? We laughed at Hibs because of the likes of Sean Maloney. We laughed at Aberdeen because of Jim Goodwin and Barry Robson and all that. But we got away with it because they were so bad and they were a mess. Now we're being found out, similar to what Hibs and Aberdeen found out, that Naismith isn't as good as it made them look to be last year when we finished third. And we're only finishing third in spite of him, because everybody else around us was fucking diabolical and shite. And now that Aberdeen have got their act together, they've got a decent manager in who's got experience, been there, done it, and got the T-shirt. Look at what they've done. Has he made many changes to that starting 11 since he started? No. The odd wee tweak here because of an injury or a suspension or whatever, but he stuck to the best, to a winning team, and he stuck with that. As soon as we get the 0-0 against Rangers, he goes and changes the formation, changes the players for the game at Dundee, and we're all over the place. And since then, we have never, ever, we haven't been anywhere near as good as we were against Rangers. And that's because of him. I think this is
a famous victory.
It's my personal opinion. This is not any inside knowledge or pretend to know something that nobody else knows. But from my interpretation of watching what we're watching, the players are not having him. They're not having him. I think they're laughing at him. And they're going up the pitch going, I'm a centre back today, right? I'm in a back three. No, I'm a back four. No, back five today. Back there, back three. Right. Okay. I'm a left centre back, but I'm right footed. Oh, okay, okay. And we're going to give a debut to our new signing who's just walked through the door at wing back. Yeah, you're going to play wing back. Yeah, you're in. We're going to play you right. And then it's a mess. I think the players are just thinking, who? You've not got a fucking clue.
So overall, just to sort of round this off.
Naismith out.
Everything that you've said there.
Naismith out.
Can you see from perhaps my perspective or producer John's perspective and many, many people who get in touch with the podcast how this is quite funny?
Do you see me laughing?
No, but I'm not expecting you to be laughing. I'm saying, but can you see from our point of view why it's quite funny?
That's annoying. I'm really annoyed and pissed off that our club, my club,
again,
I've become a laughing stock.
It's quite funny. Because as I mentioned earlier on in the podcast, Dunfermline have had a shocking start to the season.
Yeah, but you expected to have a poor season.
Yeah.
That's the difference. So I can't really rip the piss out of you for that.
No, you can't. And that's what makes this podcast great. And thank you for all your comments over the weekend and all the tweets that have been put to me.
And even if Hearts turn that around and we start challenging at the top end of the table and we go in an unbeaten run of 6 or 7 games, it will be in spite of Stephen Naismith. I am not having him. I am not ever going to have Stephen Naismith. He's not the right man for Heart of Midlothian Football Club. And I want to finish by what I started with. Funded by fans, ran by absolute clowns. And it needs to change.
Okay, let's move on to the championship then. And don't really want to talk about the championship this week.
The championship.
It's terrible. A really poor league. And we'll have a void season.
But see when it...
Come on, boys. Sing the song.
So what was Morton's score at the weekend?
So Morton drew with Livingston 1-1. Livingston have signed Stevie May as well.
That's right.
I think it's on loan from St Johnstone.
That's good signing for them.
So 1-1. And by the way, I think Livingston will be there or thereabouts.
You said that all season.
I don't think they'll be far away.
Do you think they'll be in the playoffs?
Yes, I do. I do think Livingston will be in the playoffs. Elsewhere, Airdrie, shocking start to the season, really, apart from beating Raith Rovers. They've lost every game since then. And 2-0 against Queen's Park on Saturday. Maybe the Reese McCabe phase is over. Maybe that, being that, linked with all those jobs has just put them off.
They were outstanding against Raith Rovers when they won that game, and then they played Ayr and they got absolutely battered, and they never really been recovered from that.
Speaking of Ayr, 2-0 winners against still managerless Raith Rovers. More on that in just a wee second. 2-0 it was to Ayr United on Saturday. Anton Dowds, and I think he scored in every game, or he scored four from four, I think. Yeah. So, yeah, it looks like Scott Brown has got them ticking over very nicely. Top of the league, 100% record.
It would appear from the outside looking in that they are the team to beat this season, because Partick Thistle have been poor, Raith Rovers have been poor, and as much as it's been a great start for Falkirk, I don't see them maintaining that.
Dunfermline play Ayr United at East End Park on Saturday as well, so that'll be fun.
That will be fun.
Raith Rovers still don't have a manager. I believe they've offered it to
Healy.
Virtually everyone now.
Is Healy not taking it?
David Healy has been offered a new contract by Linfield.
So has he said no to Raith Rovers?
He's got a decision to make, basically.
So he's not made it yet?
He's not made it. What I do find a bit bizarre, apparently David Healy turned down the Preston North End job.
That's his club.
Yeah, and he was there for years. So, but apparently, there's...
There'd been more money at Preston as well.
Yeah. So I find that a bit bizarre, but it could be David Healy. It's definitely not going to be the five or six people that they've offered it to previously. So Raith Rovers still looking for a new manager.
What is it? Raith Rovers are a big club. I know they're your rivals. You're going to laugh at even the thought of that. But they are a big club with a really good fan base and got a rich history.
Are we talking about Raith Rovers?
Yeah, what I find really interesting and quite strange, Stephen, is this. Why is nobody interested in that job?
I think that's a question for Andy Barrowman, the CEO, to be honest with you.
If I was Andy Barrowman, I'd be a wee bit worried why nobody is interested in this job. And the people that you've offered it to have all said, nah, you're all right. And there's David Healy considering staying at Linfield.
Well, we'll see what happens. They will get a new manager eventually.
This rate will be me.
Falkirk apparently won at the weekend 2-1 against Partick Thistle.
It's never a sending off. That's what won them the game.
Exactly.
They never were, a set. Two dodgy yellow cards. The
pro Falkirk bias continues in the championship.
You can't tell me the first yellow card was a yellow card.
It was dubious. Maybe.
John, be honest.
Have a look. Yeah, I would say it was a yellow card.
See, even you're doubting yourself whether that was a
but
yellow card.
I have to say, right. The dive from Ben Stanway was embarrassing.
Right. Okay, but do you think both yellow cards, the two yellow cards, was enough for a red?
Yes.
So basically, Falkirk, everything stacked against them. Everyone stacked for them, I should say. Partick Thistle, Falkirk didn't even let their fans into the stadium as well, because they're
how pathetic is that?
Really poor and pathetic.
I mean, football fans travelling across the country
to go and see their team and then they turn up out. And they don't get to see the first half hour of the game. Presumably they still charge them the full price as well. Really poor from Falkirk on Saturday.
You should be better than that.
Scraping a win, really.
6,500 people at the game as well, by the way.
Yeah, and nearly a half. Well, 500 of them were outside waiting to get in.
Aye, precisely. Yeah, exactly. Having to peer through a fence to watch the game. Partick Thistle, poor start to the season for them. Falkirk's lucky run goes on. And Dunfermline, they weren't playing at the weekend, so we'll just move on.
You had chances against Hamilton.
We can't score and we can't defend, which is a bad combination.
I know we've just said there in the transfer news that you've just signed a centre-back from Birmingham.
Tommy Fogarty.
Yeah.
He's the one I wanted, to be fair.
Are you going to be signing a striker on loan, or you think? Are you hearing anything?
I don't know. I mean, the problem is now, it's obviously good that we're signing players and we're getting people in, but we're now getting towards the end of the transfer window when everyone's been signed up.
So how many players do you think you need to bring in?
11. in an ideal world, we would have brought in like four or five quality players over the summer. But we didn't, because they're all signed with other teams.
So as it stands right now for Dunfermline, get a couple of players in before Friday, and it's all about just staying in the league and not getting dragged into relegation battle.
So here's the script, obviously. The German consortium, who are the majority shareholders, have put the club, or their stake up for sale. There are some talks continuing with interested parties already.
Yeah.
There are people interested.
Do you know who they are?
I don't know who they are. I don't have any more information, but there are definitely... there are interested parties.
Is it not Sheikh Zayed? Is it Sheikh Nayan?
I don't think so, unfortunately.
Not the Abu Dhabi or Dubai or anywhere like that?
Don't think
Qatar,
so.
Qatar?
No, I don't think so. But anyway, there are interested parties, which is good. However, they're probably going to have to stump up, you know, £2 or 3 million anyway.
Yeah.
Which is a lot of money. But anyway, so that's the state of play in terms of... they've also appointed a broker to do the deal. So
it's definitely happening then.
So it is happening. The other thing is, you know, both the manager, James McPake, who will be under pressure over the next, or he's under pressure already, but, you know, if we keep losing, he will lose his job. He's not going to get sacked imminently. Both he and the chief executive slash chairman, they said to the majority shareholders in April that we need to improve the squad for next season. And were basically stonewalled the entire way through until the last week.
I suppose you can't really blame James McPake when you're not getting the help you need from the people above you. But there does come a point where the fans are going to...
His hands have been tied, absolutely. However, that we still should be doing a wee bit. But he has signed all of these players still.
Yeah, and you know that game against Air United, you can't get obliterated against them, or there might be no James McPake this time next week.
Well, we'll see. We'll see what happens. Obviously, it's an international break after that, so we'll see what happens.
That's what normally happens. They get rid of the manager, gives them 2 weeks to get a new manager in.
Right then, let's move down into League One. Kelty Hearts and Alloa both remaining unbeaten and 8 points at the top of the league.
I had Kelty on my coupon and they drew.
Against Inverness, 0-0. So, yeah, it was... I don't think it was the most exciting game in the world. Alloa beating Annan by a goal to nil. I think Alloa are going to have a decent season.
You said that.
I don't think they'll be far away. Arbroath were 2-0 up at Dumbarton. Managerless, remember Arbroath, because they binned Jim McIntyre last week, but they managed to chuck the lead away and it finished 2-2. Stenhousemuir beat Cove by 3-2. Cove having a stinking season as well.
We said that at the start of the season.
Paul Hartley. And Montrose beating Queen of the South in the late game on Saturday night, which was on BBC Alaba. Okay, League 2, Peterhead still unbeaten. They drew away at Spartans 0-0. Bonnyrigg Rose beating Clyde by 2-1. Edinburgh City thumping Forfar 3-0. And we also had a big win for East Fife. So Dick Campbell is getting them raring to go for their title tilt. Nathan Austin is there as well, who's been about the leagues and scored plenty of goals. And it finished 1-1 between Elgin and Stranraer at Stranraer. Okay, that is you right up to date. Let's go to some refereeing disasters or not, shall we?
La gente está muy loca. What the fuck?
Right, let's go straight to Dundee United St Johnston. Obviously, Sidibe getting sent off, 2 yellows, then a straight red.
Yeah.
I think he got it right as well. A claim for a penalty in the first half. Not giving that. Nothing much to report at the Rangers game.
One-way traffic.
Hibs Dundee. It was Colin Stephen who was in charge. So there was the offside goal for Dundee. Now,
I'm going to disagree with this one.
So for those of you who haven't seen it, it was an initial shot
from Cameron.
And it hit, I think it hit Palmer Holden.
Yes, it did.
And then it dropped straight back out.
No.
Did it?
So the strike comes in from Cameron on the edge of the box.
Yes.
It hits a Dundee player who's slightly marginally offside.
He's offside.
It hits his side and then it flicks in front of a Hibs defender.
Uh-huh.
Who scuffs his clearance. It goes back to Cameron and then Cameron scores from that. I'm pretty sure that... that's a second phase of play because Hibs have control of the ball. This Hibs defender makes a scuff clearance. So is that not a second phase of play?
If I'm Dundee, I
am crying that that goal is not being given.
See
if it rebounds off the Dundee striker straight back to Cameron and he scores it, fair enough. But I genuinely believe there's a mistake being made here. So it bounces off his hip and it goes across the 6-yard line. The Hibs defender clears it, but he scuffs it. Cameron's on the edge of the box, hits it from 20 yards, and it goes into the back of the net. I think that's a second phase of play. I think that's a goal for Dundee, and I think they're extremely unlucky. I think VAR and the referee get that wrong.
I'm going to disagree. I think they got it right. I think...
Right, so how far do you pull it back? If the defender who's got control,
I don't think the defender was obviously in control.
He cleared it, but
you said he scuffed his clearance.
Does it matter? That's him. That's his mistake.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't.
How far do you call it back then, Stephen? See if it rebounded straight off the Dundee.
It all happened within about 5 seconds.
See if that rebounded straight off the Dundee player went straight to the Cameron. Then I'm going, yeah, it's offside. You can't have that. But because it's cleared by a Hibs defender. Do you not see what I'm saying?
No, I see what you're saying, but I just think
you still think that's offside.
I still think it's the same phasey play. I do. I genuinely do. Okay. I do. Right, Aberdeen Kilmarnock, Brad Lyons tackle on Sockler.
Me and George has been talking about that.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I don't know.
I can see why in this day and age. But they do have a problem there, because is that not like 3 sending offs in their last 3 games?
Yeah.
They've got some... What's the word I'm looking for? They've got a thing with problem?
A disciplinary
problem.
I mean, I don't think they do. I think... Yeah.
Well, they have in recent games. I can see why he was sent off.
Okay. Celtic St Mirren. Stevie McLean was in charge of VAR. Maeda, potential foul in the box. Potential foul on McGregor in the box as well.
And McGregor won, though, that. But the boys just stood his ground and McGregor's ran into him. And Maeda won. Yeah, possibly.
Yeah,
but do you know what? See the hint of the day.
It doesn't matter.
It didn't matter.
Anyway, right, there you are. Nothing to do in the other game. So let's move on to overrated, underrated, but this is the Big Scottish Football Podcast.
The Big Scottish Football Podcast.
Told you.
With Stephen Mill and Ewan Cameron.
Right, time for overrated, underrated. Ewan, you're on from last week. You put subs applauding the crowd and crowd applauding the subs is overrated.
I don't get it. I saw it yesterday as
Twitter
well.
Twitter has spoken.
I saw it yesterday.
64.5% of people say, no, it's not overrated.
Wait. You've just jumped in it. We need a drum roll and build it up.
No, we don't need to.
John, give us a drum roll. Do that. Let's pretend that didn't. Oh, wait, I'm not ready yet.
Right. Stop. 64.5%.
Wait, right. Last week, I said overrated.
Drum roll, please, John.
No, wait.
All right, sorry. We'll get done, right. Sorry.
Just, for those who missed it.
Yeah.
Right. We put out a poll on Twitter.
64.5%.
Not yet. Let me explain it.
Sorry.
When a substitute goes behind the goal and...
64.5%.
No. And then the substitute applauds the fans when he goes behind the goal. What's that all about? And then the fans applaud him back. Really weird. So I said it's a bit overrated.
64.5%.
Wait. Right, okay. It's a bit over the top. And here's the result. Is it overrated or not? Drum roll now, you prick. Not the... What's the result? Is it overrated or no?
Sorry?
Is it overrated?
I was waiting for...
Did the drum roll.
John, give me a drum roll.
Fuck's sake. Amateur.
64.5% of people say no, it's not overrated. So you're wrong, Ewan.
So why am I getting the happy music as if I was right?
Because everyone else was right. You were wrong.
Right. Yeah.
Right, my turn to nominate something this week.
No, see, before we do that, can I nominate something?
For God's sake, what?
What's wrong?
Just do it.
You have to bleep this out, producer John. Overrated, man.
Ewan, you know when the footballers cover their mouths to talk tactics, you're really going to have to start doing it at this point, because there's a lot of lip readers out there.
You ever done it?
Hell!
Have you?
No!
Has anyone ever asked you to do it and you've refused?
Well, no.
I've had somebody ask me to do it once and I was disgusted.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow!
What really, as in... I found it disgusting, or really
somebody asked you to do that.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And I said, no my thing. I've got OCD when it comes to stuff
right,
like that.
Right, enough.
So you've definitely, even in your drunkest moments.
No.
Did you ever wake up thinking...
No, I didn't. No, I didn't. Fucking hell. This needs to stop.
Well, it's not. It's overrated and underrated, so I just want to get your reaction to some of the things that people... I mean, see, when I've been in a pub with my pals, we've discussed things like that, and we're going, nah, I've never tried that, or well, I've tried that before.
Right, that's fine, because you're in the pub with your pals.
That's no very good, or that's quite overrated, or that's not as good as I thought it would be. I've tried it, but it's no very good, and I wouldn't do it again. Are you open to it?
No. No, I'm not.
At all?
No.
John? Producer John?
No.
No. Anyone ever asked you?
No!
If they asked you, what would you say?
No!
What, for you to do it or for them to do it?
Both.
Both, okay. What if it was the other way around, Stephen?
No!
No, okay. But what if they really wanted it? What if it was make or break for your relationship?
Break.
Right, anyway, let's go to it. Overrated, underrated, what you got?
I'm going to go for an underrated this week.
Okay.
And the underrated is something that I've actually spoken about on this podcast before, and so have you.
Have we?
On this podcast before.
Is it something to do with football?
Yes. And I'm going, Cyriel Dessers is underrated. Cyriel Dessers is underrated. Okay?
That's a brilliant question.
He has scored a lot of goals. Now, we can discuss the merits of them and which games he scores them in, but I think he is nowhere near as bad as people make out. And, you know, we've slagged him off on this show before.
Yeah, particularly me.
Particularly you.
Yeah.
But I think that Cyriel Dessers is underrated. I think he's a good striker who will score you lots and lots of goals.
And is it the team around him that are bad?
I think possibly.
That's a brilliant question.
I think Rangers, particularly last season, you know, without going down and getting involved in Cantwell Gate again, I think there was a lot. He was, for example, very overrated, and a lot of emphasis was put on the Rangers midfield, but yet he still scored, what, 20 odd goals last season?
22 or something, 23 goals or something?
He's got, what, 6 already this season?
Yeah.
That's a great question. Cyriel Dessers. He's
just scored against Ross County. We're watching it here.
Cyriel Dessers, underrated.
See, that's a good finish.
It is up to you to vote at Big Football Scott on Twitter. You can get involved on Instagram, on Facebook, on Bebo, whatever it is. And you can leave your comments on our YouTube channel as well. Just search for Clyde One Super Scoreboard on YouTube. Sign up as well. Subscribe to us so you get notifications every time new videos go live. And remember, Clyde One Super Scoreboard is on the air every night from 6 o'clock, taking your calls across Glasgow and the West. Gordon Duncan and the team. And of course, me and Ewen are on every single Saturday with the Big Saturday Football Show across 4th1 West FM, TFM, MFR and NORTHSOUND 1 with former Hibs and Aberdeen striker Steve Cowan.
So it's weird that you asked that question as we're watching the highlights of Rangers versus Ross County from the weekend there, and his link-up play, very good. Tom Lawrence should have scored the goal there.
You know, it's taken me a while, but I think he's underrated. I think he's underrated. I think he gets a bad rap.
It'll be really interesting to see what the reaction will be to that question.
Well, it's up to you. At Big Football Scott. Right, we have a mystery footballer on this show.
Oh,
he
we
is
do.
The masked footballer. Right, so producer John has sourced a mystery footballer, and we need to guess who it is through a series of yes or no questions.
We're allowed one question a week.
We know that the masked footballer hasn't played internationally at senior level, but has at youth levels. What did we discover last week as well? He hasn't played for... Oh, God, I can't remember what we asked last week.
It was something to do with... Was it Hearts or Hibs or something?
No,
what was
you
it?
Wanted to ask that.
Yeah, no, what was it? How can we not remember the question we had last week?
I can't remember what the question was last, because John hasn't written it down for us, so we don't remember.
No, sorry, I wasn't on last week.
Yeah. Oh, so it's somebody else's fault.
Yeah, somebody else's fault.
You can't remember. Was it not like you said Easter? Did they play in the East?
No, we were going to do that, but then we changed our mind.
Then I got upset with the question that you...
Yeah, and then you got upset despite saying, that's an amazing question. You were like, oh, that's an amazing question, ask that, and then I asked that,
was
and then we got a rubbish
Hibs?
Answer.
No, it wasn't Hibs, was it? We need note before we ask
was
this question.
Was that a non-league?
No.
Yeah.
No. We've had a couple of people getting in touch with their questions. Rua says, for the mass footballer, maybe ask if they've won any domestic trophies. It's quite a good question.
That's a good question.
John says, did the mass footballer play in Northern Ireland?
Why are they asking that specifically? Why do they think they know who it is?
think possibly. Are you going through last week's podcast now?
Yeah, brilliant.
According to you and Cameron.
Oh, yeah, I've got, I found it. Hold on. I've already...
What clubs was he with?
Right, we've got... Right.
You just keep saying... I'll listen to... You're going to... Are you finished doing what you're doing?
Yeah, just...
Be careful how you freeze it.
Okay, right, I'm ready for the question.
Okay.
Has our mass footballer played for any of the teams that either Ewan, me, or producer John support on this podcast?
Nah.
There you go.
Right, so they haven't played with Hearts, Dunfermline, or Falkirk.
Yeah, that's it. That was the question. Brilliant.
Right, what do you want to go for this week? I do like Rua's question, actually.
Which one?
Have they won any domestic trophies?
Does that, but does domestic trophy just mean in the professional league? It's not like in Scottish Cups that they won as a 15-year-old or something.
No, obviously. Have they won the League Cup or the Scottish Cup?
Yeah. But what if they've won something like the Tunnocks Cup thing?
Like that. John, can we get 1.5 questions this week?
That's not the game, boys. One question and one question only.
Unless we... But see if we ask the question, have they won the Scottish Cup, League Cup or Premier League? And he goes, no, but they may have won the Tunnocks Cup.
No, no.
The Challenge Cup.
I know. Whereas if we go, have you won any domestic trophy? Can we clarify what we mean by domestic trophies?
Yeah, go and clarify that one
okay,
for me, John.
Okay, I'll let you offer that one. If you say, have you won the Scottish Cup, the League or the League Cup?
See, him saying that suggests to me he hasn't. I think that's probably not already, because he's quite happy for us to ask that question, because he wants it to be not.
No, because I would describe them as the major honours. I wouldn't...
Major honours, but what if...
Like,
if they've won,
like, the Championship or the Challenge Cup or League One. Right.
If they won any kind of domestic trophy, but then...
But then that doesn't narrow it down. Lots of people have won.
I know.
So that's what... Why don't we go with the League, Scottish Cup or League Cup?
What was the question again? Who was it from?
Rua. Have they won any domestic trophies? I would say domestic major trophies. So the League Cup or Scottish Cup.
As in the Premiership or any league?
Yeah, no, the Premiership. Has to be the Premiership.
Not League One, Championship or League Two?
No, because that opens it up to so many more people. That could be anyone.
Is that not a wasted question then?
I don't know. What were the other routes we were going to go down? We were going to go down like...
Specific.
Have you ever been a pundit on Superscoreboard?
Yeah, we're going to do stuff like that. But see, I don't think you will have been. But then,
if we ask that and it's no, then that's a wasted question.
But there again, there's been so many pundits over the years. And
however,
pundits,
if we do go for it, it does narrow, and it's a yes, it narrows it down quite considerably.
But if they say no, then we're basically back to where we were.
I know. That's what we need to decide.
I don't think it's a pundit on Super Scoreboard. I just don't. And if it is, it'll be somebody that's maybe done it once in their life.
Yeah, but that's...
But remember, the player's playing again. He's playing.
Yeah, he is playing. Yeah,
he is
that
playing.
Is true.
He's a current player.
What do you think then?
I mean, I do like that question, but I'm worried that we ask it, meaning those three trophies, and they might have won a championship or a league trophy or a challenge cup.
Aye, but we can't worry about that.
Right, go on then. Ask that question.
Okay, right. I'm ready for the question,
and
John.
And we'll blame
right.
Rua.
Rua, we're going with your question, pal.
Yeah. It better be an I.
Has our masked footballer... I can't say masked, honestly.
You just did.
I know, but it's really difficult for me to say. Has our masked footballer ever won any of the domestic major trophies?
Aye.
Right. So they've won a Scottish Cup, a League Cup, or all three.
That, well done, Rua.
Well done. Good question.
Right. Great, Rua. Geezer question for next week as well.
Yeah, get your questions in. We're narrowing it down now at Big Football Score and on YouTube as well. Leave your questions and comments there.
Super Scoreboard.
Yeah.
Who's on there that's won cups and leagues? Kenny Miller?
Mm-hmm.
Gordon DL?
Mm-hmm.
Mark Wilson?
Jim
Duffy, did he?
Yeah. Jim Duffy.
Did he win a major honour?
I don't think Jim Duffy's still playing, though. I think that's probably... You can probably rule him out.
Oh, I forgot about that. That's Kenny Miller as well. So it's no Kenny. It's no Mark. What's none of them? Scott Allen?
Scott Allen.
Did he win
the Scottish Cup?
Did he win? He must have done with Celtic, no, as a sub or something, because he never played that much. John, because you produce Super Scoreboard.
Yeah.
Scott Allen, see you on often?
Now and again.
Now and again. So you would describe him as a super scoreboard pundit?
He's been, I guess so. He's been on quite a bit recently.
Remember, 2 weeks ago somebody said to us about Scott Allen, and he is a player that's playing for Celtic and playing well.
Yeah.
He is a current player. I still probably...
But is that too obvious?
That's what I'm saying. That's why I wouldn't waste my time saying anything.
I mean, if it ends up being Scott Allen, John...
I'll be pissed off.
I'll be super, super annoyed at you.
That's just lazy.
Really lazy.
Yeah.
So I'll be annoyed at that.
We're just warning you now, mate.
Let's get round the grounds because we've been doing this so far this season, just checking in with one particular team, one particular fan from each of the clubs. We've had Inverness fans on, Kilmarnock fans with the Rangers fan on. And this week, we have Liam from the Hibs Ramble podcast. So it's not been a great start to the season, but let's get Liam's thoughts on it. Liam, are you there?
I am here. How are we getting on, guys?
Very well.
Can I first say that, Liam, I wish you were on when Hearts had won and you'd lost.
Well, that's not been very recently. Hearts have went however many days without getting a win yet.
Do you know what it is? We've had one win in 14 games.
Yeah, that's poor.
That's our recent record.
Relegation power, that.
But you've got the same amount of points as us, which is one. However, I was saying earlier in the podcast, Liam, despite your issues and your problems, I think you've got a player in Bowie.
Yeah, I think so as well. Really liked the look at him when he came on against Celtic for his debut, and then obviously gets the goal on Saturday there. Really powerful striker. Someone that we've been kind of missing, that kind of player, maybe since Christian Deutsch left. But for everyone else, there's no pulling in with the goals. Hopefully Stephen Bowie can pull his weight and get some this season.
Yeah, 100%. Obviously, David Gray's an absolute legend. His legendary status is, you know, not going to be affected, no matter really how this ends. But it's... What's going on? It just seems like it looks like a shambles defensively and a shambles off the pitch as well.
Yeah, listen, I've not got a bad word to say about David Gray, and I think he could probably go through his whole Hibs career as a manager without getting a win and still leave with his legacy untarnished. But I don't really know what's happening on the pitch at the moment. It's pretty shambolic. Obviously, we brought in a couple of new centre halves. Maybe it's taken a wee bit of time for them to, you know, get used to each other. But, you know, the professional footballers, they should be really being able to keep the ball at the net is like more than they've been able to this season. It's been pretty poor. And, you know, I feel like the recruitment as a whole has been half decent. It'd be even better if we managed to get Luke McEwen over the line. But I really don't know what's going on at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it sounds like there's a sort of battle going on in the boardroom as well. You've got the Gordons obviously still there. You've got your boy for Bournemouth, and you know you've got Ben Kensel still there. It just seems like there's no harmony at all. It seems like nobody's pulling in the same direction.
No, not at all. You know, there's quite a lot of unrest among the support as well. A lot of people are wanting Kensel and Gordon out and stuff like that. I mean, I've not really got as strong an opinion on that as some other fans, but listen, I think everyone kind of needs to get sat around a table and decide what direction they want to pull the club in and get it done quickly, because I genuinely think if we keep playing it the way that we're playing, there's no way we're going to get top six.
Yeah, I was going to say, what constitutes a good season for you then, Liam, for Hibs?
Well, historically for me, I mean, I would be looking at pushing third, fourth, but you know, realistically, this season, it's not going to happen unless we get our act together very, very quickly and put together a really good run of results. But I think first and foremost, we've got to get to the top six. You know, and if you get there, sometimes it's fifth place that can get you a European spot. So if we end the season in the top six with Europe the following season, I think... I wouldn't say it's a success, but I would say it's definitely a step in the right direction.
Yeah, because you look at the teams over the last sort of few years that have ended up finishing third, like Aberdeen, like Hearts, obviously. Kilmarnock had a cracking season last season. I mean, Hibs haven't had a decent season since you finished third under Jack Ross, which is, what, 4 years ago now?
Yeah, it's just been really inconsistent, to be honest. I think it's the amount of managers that we're going through. No club is going to get any success from that at all. You know, I've been pretty vocal on the podcast about talking about, you know, we can't keep sacking managers every 6 months and going through 2-3 managers a season. It's just not how successful clubs are ran. I mean, you look at Hearts, a lot of people wanted Stephen Naismith out. A lot of people still do want Stephen Naismith out. But Hearts' hierarchy have stuck with him. And, you know, the success has come from that. You know, third place is obviously where we want to be. So, I mean, I just think that we need to have a little bit of belief in what we're trying to do and not just pull the trigger the second things go wrong.
Here's the thing, though. How long can this continue? I think, I mean, David Gray, as you say, legend at the club. He'll forever be known for that header against Rangers and what a day that was for Hibs. Even I was happy for you. But how long do the Hibs fans give him? How much patience will they have with David Gray before they go, right, this isn't working with him at the helm?
Well, I sort of thought that when David Gray first got the job, he would maybe have a little bit more credit in the bank and be able to get a little bit more patience out of the supporters than a Montgomery or a Johnson or a Maloney, something like that, just purely because of, you know, his history with the club. It's not looking great at the moment, Ewen, but I tell you what, there was real good signs of improvement performance-wise on Saturday there, especially second half. You know, and if we can get a couple more bodies into the door and maybe shift a wee bit of the dead wood, then, you know, there's definitely the skeleton there of a half-decent footballing team.
Yeah. I think we've both said that, to be fair. Like,
we said it.
Like, I think Hibs going forward do a lot of good things.
Midfield to front, front. And when Kieran Bowie's up to speed and he's fully fit, we talked about it earlier, I generally think you've got a cracking striker there. And we boil on one side. And what's the situation with Johan? I know there's been speculation about him possibly leaving, but boil on one side, Johan on the other, and you've got Bowie up front, and you've got some options in midfield. I do think the Hibs have got a really decent side midfield to front, and it remains to be seen whether or not the centre-halves are any good. As you say, it might take them a wee bit of time to gel, who knows? But I think you've got the makings of a decent side there.
We really do. Ellie Ewan, I think, is going to be pivotal if we can keep a hold of him. He's injured at the moment, but if we can keep him in the building, I don't know if he wants to still be at Hibs or not. He got an awful lot of stick from the supporters last season, unwarranted, I think. Mm-hmm. You know, he was with the sort of numbers that he put up last season and the season before. He's probably been one of our best signings in the last 5-6 years.
Agreed. So
people that are doubting him, I think he can be a very, very frustrating player, Ewan, because sometimes his decision making just isn't there. But like I've said on the pod 110 times, you know, if his decision making was perfect and everything else was great, he wouldn't be at Hibs.
That's true.
Totally.
He's actually one of those players that I think he scored a couple of goals against us at Tynecastle. Was it last season? I think it was. Yeah. Was it the 2-2 game? And I was waxing lyrical about the boy. Yeah, he's inconsistent, but I would love him at Hearts.
Yeah, well, listen, he can have a game and he plays 88 poor minutes and he pops up with a couple of magic moments there, and I only gained us a point in the grand scheme of things, but you know, that kind of could have really kick-started our season, and, you know, better than getting beat 2-0, I suppose. Eh?
Yeah, totally. Just to go back very briefly to the managerial situation, obviously you mentioned, Ewan mentioned what like Aberdeen have done by putting Barry Robson in, or Hearts have done putting Stephen Naismith in.
Sean Maloney coming in.
Like, Hibs have tried every kind of manager. They've gone for managers who have had success, like in other countries, like Nick Montgomery.
Yeah.
They've tried the young and upcoming manager like Sean Maloney. You know, they've tried Jack Ross. Like, it seems like you've tried everything. So you just want a wee bit of stability over the next wee while. And yeah, it might not be perfect, but, you know, if there's anyone who deserves a chance, it's David Gray.
Absolutely. And I think for a long time, I mean, probably even still, the Hibs job's a bit of a poison chalice.
Yeah.
You know, you think back to, you know, Leeds in the 2010s, every manager that went in there didn't get any success and was booted out in the first few months. So it's just kind of, I think, as an outsider looking in, if I wasn't a Hibs fan and if I was a managerial candidate, I wouldn't be touching that job with a 10-foot barge pole. No way. Mm. But I think we really, really, really need to just believe in David Gray, believe in what he wants to build, and give him the backing. I think he's had the backing this summer, but we need to get behind him as a fan base and make sure that we're in the European conversation come the end of the year.
And the reason that nobody would touch the jaw with a 10-foot barge pole is because nobody wants to go to Leith. It's Leith.
I don't know about that.
It's Leith. It's just smelly.
Leith's lovely.
Better than Gordie,
isn't it? Leith is cosmopolitan now.
Well, that's true. They've got little tables outside their pubs.
Exactly. They've got tables outside now.
Tables so, outside their pubs. Anyway. What was? I don't know if you'll remember this, Liam, but when Hibs won the Scottish Cup, I came up with this amazing idea when I was working at STV. I'm a Hearts man. Everyone knows I'm a Hearts man. I says, let me take a cameraman down Easter Road the day after the Scottish Cup. Mm-hmm. And you'd won it. And I went to the stadium to see if there was any fans hanging about. And a lot of the fans were hanging about. And they said, oh, Martin Boyle's round the corner. Mm-hmm. He's in a pub. What would in the pub the Hibs players would have been at, Liam? You'll know better than me. There's a pub where all the Hibs fans hang about on near Easter Road.
There's the Harp and Castle, which is a good one. I usually go to the Iona with my old man and a couple of the boys. But
I don't know, but I went in and it was the biggest mistake of my life. I mean, Martin Boyle was in there. Sorry?
Was it the Four in Hand, maybe?
That sounds about right, yeah.
Yeah, so, it's not there anymore.
Right, and I walked in to see if Martin Boyle was in there. And not only was Martin Boyle in there, but there was a whole host of other Hibs players in there all dancing and singing. It's like 12 o'clock in the afternoon.
Oh, it would have been.
The day after.
Of course it would have been.
Oh my God, what a mistake that was. You'll see it on YouTube. But the Hibs fans gave me it tight.
Good.
What was I thinking?
Just,
I don't know.
I know.
Being you.
Being a Hearts fan, turning up on the day that Hibs have won the Scottish Cup, what an idiot. But Martin Boyle, lovely guy. I like Martin Boyle. Got a lot of time for him.
Yeah, hopefully he can get back.
The other thing about Martin Boyle, though, he's flattered to deceive this season. I know he scored the free kick yet on Saturday there, but he needs to be better than he's been.
Is he back up to speed like what it was before his injury, Liam?
I just don't think he's ever properly recovered from that.
Yeah. Really?
Which is a shame. You know, he's lost maybe a little bit, half a yard of that pace. He's still very, very clever player. But, no, listen, I think people are expecting Martin Boyle now to be the Martin Boyle that he was 4 or 5 years ago. And it's just not going to happen. He's getting older. You know, the body's maybe starting to give in a wee bit.
Long may that continue.
Liam, from the Hibs Ramble podcast, thanks very much for coming on the show, chatting all things Hibs this morning. All the best, pal.
Thank you. Have a good one, guys.
Cheers, mate. Bye-bye.
There he goes. There is Liam from the Hibs Ramble podcast. We'll get someone else on next week. But now it's time for the highlight of the podcast. It is quiz time. Our shootout quiz. Here we go. And here is our quiz master this week. It is producer John.
I'm Hello, back, John. Baby. I'm
You're back.
Back.
I need to go and get a pen. So wait there.
Right. Okay. You're going to cheer up, Ewen.
What?
I'm just going to cheer up.
If I win the quiz, that would make my week.
Right.
It would make up for what has been a
I've
really.
Been listening.
Shite
I've been
weekend.
Listening to the podcast. The questions, by the way, are pretty tough from the guys that. Yeah. Been Michael and Scott.
I'm sure now that you're back on quiz questions, I'll be pish about Stenhouse Muir.
Maybe.
So, the rules of the quiz. 5 questions, we get the same question each. At any point, either one of us can jump in with our top bin question that's worth 2 points. That will substitute in for our normal question.
Yeah.
And just remind us, what's the score so far this season in terms of the quizzes, John?
Well, that's a very good question.
3-0.
Is it 3-0 to you still, Stephen?
Yeah, I think it might be. It's not 4-0. I think it's 5-0. 4 or 5-0 is
enough. I think it went, there was arguments last week where it was 3-0. So if it was 3-0 last week, it'll be 4-0.
I think it's 4-0. Anyway, 4-0. You're on nil, which is the most important
thing.
Yeah,
well, we need to find out what the actual score is for my comeback.
Yeah, you're on nil and I'm on all of them so far. So, right, are we ready for question number one?
We certainly are.
Okay, let's go for it.
Right, okay, question number one. Luis Palma joined Celtic from a club in which country? Luis Palma joined a club, Celtic from a club in which country?
What club did he sign from?
I don't know. I genuinely don't know this. Luis Palma. Oh, wait, no, I don't know.
Luis Palma.
I think I do know.
You want the country that he signed from?
Yeah, that's the question.
I'm just double checking.
Luis Palma joined Celtic from a club in which country? Not the actual club, I just need the country. Made it even easier for you.
Why were you questioning that and like tutting?
Because it's a fairly straightforward question.
Yeah, but I'm just double checking on it.
No,
he doesn't want the club, he wants the country and the club he played in.
Ewan, I think I'm probably about 60% certain on this one. That's my certainty rate on this one.
Ewan, you got an answer yet? Time is a ticking.
Come on, Ewan. Write your answer down on your wee iPad thing. You got your answer? You happy?
I'm not happy.
Nah, I'm not overly happy either.
No. Right, okay then. Stephen, what have you went for?
I went for Sweden.
Ewan, what have you went to?
See, I was considering Sweden, but then I went Germany.
You're both
wrong.
Who is it?
It was from Greece, Aris Thessaloniki. Yeah. Apparently.
There I wouldn't have got that, I'll be honest. Right. I wouldn't have got that. Just happy he didn't get it right, so I'm still in it, really.
You're still in it. Right? Okay, right, next we'll question.
Yeah.
In what decade did Spain last lose a European qualifier at home? In what decade?
Decade?
Did Spain last lose a European qualifier at home?
Decade?
Yeah. I'm between two.
So am I. It'll be the same two as me. Be the 90s or the noughties. I don't remember them losing a game in the 10s. Have they lost a... No, they've not lost any in this decade. It's the 90s or the noughties. Ask the question again.
In what decade did Spain last lose a European qualifier at home?
Right, I've got my answer.
You got your answer. Right, okay.
You go first, Ewan.
Have you written something down?
Yeah.
I've went to 2000s.
Noughties for you and Stephen.
I also went for the noughties.
All right, okay, that's good. So I can't be falling behind here.
These are both right.
Yeah. It's like 2002 or something, 2001.
2003.
Who was it?
Greece.
The European, or the soon-to-be European champions.
Ah, yeah.
Right.
Right, okay then.
1-1, question three. I'm getting a wee bit excited.
Who were the first team to be relegated from the Scottish top flight via the playoffs? Who were the first team to be relegated from the Scottish top flight via the playoffs?
It's one or two for me. You got an answer?
Yep. I've got the right answer.
How'd you know?
Because I know the answer. I was reading about it this week.
Oh my god, how many times have we heard that? I was reading about it this week. Oh, and that's what starts conspiracy theories, because we think that you're in cahoots with producer John, because this piss you come out with. It's weird, isn't it, how this has happened a few times when you're on questions, John, where this Muppet beside me goes, oh, it just so happens that a question that John has asked me, I was reading about this week. Wow.
Just write an answer then, Ewan.
I'm just a well-read man.
Well-read man, my arse. But I've got an answer. Right. I can turn the fucking music off.
Right. It's me to go first.
I read about it.
I read about it this week and I think the answer's Hibs.
I said Hibs. Get in!
2-2.
And it was against Hamilton.
It was against Hamilton.
You know why I know that? Because I was there that day.
There you go.
Well, good for you.
Right.
I also thought it might have been Dundee United. Did Dundee United not lose a final?
No.
Did they not?
No.
Oh, well.
Right, question number four.
Yes! Get
in! Number four.
2-2 a minute!
How many venues in total have been announced for Euro 2028 in UK and Ireland? How many venues in total have been announced for Euro 2028 in the UK and Ireland?
Do we get one either side of the right answer?
No.
You need a bang on the money.
Bang on the money.
How many venues in the UK and Ireland?
Yeah.
Well, no Croke Park's one. How many venues? Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
Stephen.
Anfield isn't one, I can tell you that.
Do we get extra points if we can name them?
No. But she's just showing off and being a prick.
I was reading about this week, actually.
right, you got Ramble. Your answer. Yeah, okay, right, okay. You and you can go first.
I went 8.
8.
I've gone for 10.
Oh, God.
So, I think, before we get the answer...
I think Hampden and Croke Park and Croke, 6 in England. Croke, that's what I think.
Croke Park is not a venue. It's the Aviva Stadium.
Oh, sorry, the Aviva. You're right, the Aviva.
Hampden is the venue in Scotland. Casement Park in Northern Ireland, because there's been loads of stuff over that. I think Cardiff is a venue. And I think 6 in England, which I believe to be Wembley, Tottenham, Everton's new stadium,
Spurs,
Villa, Newcastle. So I think 10.
Oh no.
You and you've went for 8, yeah?
I went for 8.
One of yous has the right answer.
Oh no!
You and read me out your answer.
8.
A mass of the same! Yes!
Come on!
I forgot about Northern Ireland and Cardiff!
Right. 10 is t- give me. No, come on, confirmation! Come
right,
on!
Alright, sorry.
Thank you! Thank you!
Tennis correct answer.
I genuinely forgot about Cardiff and Northern Ireland.
He takes the lead. Header at the back post.
If I'd remembered Cardiff and Northern Ireland, I would have had the 10 as well.
3-2, final question. Final Ewan, question. Do you want to go for your top bin here?
No.
No, right.
No.
You're just going to hope that I get wrong and you get right.
I'm going to a playoff.
Right,
okay.
Oh.
Okay.
So,
how did I not remember Cardiff and Northern Ireland?
Here is the state of play. It's me 3, Ewan 2. Final question. If Ewan gets this wrong, I've won.
Right, okay.
So all the pressure's on you
why
here.
Why do you have to keep reminding people? They can work out in their own head. And we've said it once. You don't need to keep repeating yourself.
I just.
You're just doing it to annoy me.
I could deliberately get this wrong.
You're doing it to annoy me. You're doing it to annoy me. Everybody knows the state of play. Just do the fucking question.
Right. Question number 5. Here we go.
Question number 5.
You need to get this right, remember.
Yeah. Who left Celtic for Southampton in July 2013? Who left Celtic for Southampton in July 2013?
I've got it. And I bet he gets it as well. He's going to get it. And I've got it. And I'm going to lose by a single point again.
Are you both writing down an answer?
Yeah, I've got it.
Oh, wow.
I've got it.
Right, you show your answer first
then. I've 100% got it.
Right.
Yeah.
You show your answer first then.
And I think you've got it as well. And right. I don't want to show my answer because it's fucking pissing me off that I didn't remember Cardiff from fucking Northern Ireland.
Come on, show your answer, Ewan. Come on.
What are you at?
I think it's Wanyama.
Wanyama.
Is that right or wrong?
Stephen, what answer have you went for?
He's got it as well.
I've gone
it's not
for
Van Dijk.
Virgil van Dijk.
It's not. It's too early for him.
Split answer.
It's too early for him. It's too early for him.
So if Ewan has it right,
it goes to a tiebreaker.
It goes to a tiebreak. If Stephen's got it right, it's a 4-2-1.
I'm pretty sure it was
Wanyama. One of you's definitely got it right.
Oh, God. Ewan. Is Wanyama too late? Is it too late for Wanyama?
Ewan, what's your answer?
It might be too late for Wanyama. It could be, I mean, how long did he go to Southampton? For 3-4 years? How long has he been at Liverpool? Did he win the Champions League with Liverpool? He did, didn't he?
What was your answer, Ewan?
Wanyama. I was putting away my iPad! I can't believe it! Oh right. My God!
It's gone to a tie break. Ewan Cameron equalises. The pouch is out and everything.
Oh my God!
This is very exciting for you, Ewan.
I've lost my pen from my iPad.
Especially seeing him in cahoots with Stephen as well.
Oh my God! Oh my God!
I didn't even Wanyama was not even in my thinking in any way whatsoever.
Yeah. Right. Tiebreak question. You ready?
No.
What's this answer?
No. Okay.
It's been a while, you listen. It's been a while.
Go.
It's been a while.
Right,
here we go. No looking at your plans and your papers, right?
How many
goals have been scored in the Premiership so far this season? How many goals have been scored in the Premiership this season?
In total?
Total.
Nearest 2 wins.
Yeah.
They've all played 3 games, haven't they? How many games is that in total? 12 teams, 3 games, 3, 12, 24, 36 games played so far. What a question! And you've definitely done the maths on this, you know it.
I'm going to double check the maths on it.
How many goals in total?
I've got an answer.
You ain't going to write down an answer.
I'm going to change it. I'm shat myself. Right, got an answer.
Right, okay, you both got an answer. Right, Ewen, what have you written down?
I've kind of gone average two a game. So I've gone for just over two a game. I've gone for 70.
I've gone for 70.
Yeah, have you written 70?
Right, both said right, 70. Right. Here's the thing, right? I wrote down something else.
No. I'm not getting you changing it.
No, but... But you could win.
No.
It's a 50-50 whether you win or not.
I don't want you changing it. I would draw. Can we have a draw?
No. There has to be a winner. There must be a winner.
Do you want me to get another tiebreak question?
No, well, you're going to get another question.
No, listen, I will change my answer.
No, I don't want you to change. Because see, if you win it by changing your answer, I'll crack up.
John, what do you think I should do? I'm happy to change my answer, right? Not because, like, I genuinely think that this is probably closer, but just to break the deadlock, I'm happy to go with my previous
answer. I could give you another tiebreak question.
I'm happy to take another tiebreak question.
Okay, we'll go another tiebreak question.
Right, just to shoot myself. What was your other answer?
My other answer was 60.
60.
If you'd went with that answer, Stephen would have won it because it's 49.
John! Why didn't you buy it? Come on! It would have been hilarious! Oh!
Shit. Right.
Right, okay. That's unbelievable for a nearest two
questions.
Why
did I change it?
Yeah, why did you change it?
I don't know.
I've got a question I've got written down
right,
here.
Right, go on then. So it's a second tiebreak question.
Second tiebreak question, right. In the top 10 goal scorers in the Scottish top flight since the start of the century. Oh no, it wouldn't have been. It would have been since the switch over to
the Scottish Premiership.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it would have been the SPFL as well, actually.
Right, you need to rethink the question.
In the top, this is what I've written down. It's you know, it's not like it's like the last, it'll be the last 30
years. What are you trying to fucking say here? Just right, say the fucking question.
Top 10 scorers in the Scottish top five, and we'll just say the last, it would have been the last 40 years.
Right.
How many have played for Celtic?
In the last 40 years.
Right, well, I'm trying to work out what the actual calculation. I think it's because it's from Transfer Market.
Right, okay.
Is it to do since the formation of the Premier League?
Yeah, since so
the formation of Premier
League. Well, 40 years ago is 1984.
No, that's wrong.
The Premier League was the 70s.
Right, is it okay. 30 years ago? Why don't you just pick?
One of the players is going back to the 90s.
Right, so, okay, yeah. So since the... Yeah. What's the early date? What's the earliest date of that player?
97.
Right, so yeah. Since 1997. Yeah. Started the SPL.
Yeah.
Right.
The top 10 goal scorers, how many have played for Celtic?
Yeah.
Since 1997.
Right, okay.
So how many out of the top 10 are Celtic players for top goal scorers since 1997?
Yeah. How many have played for Celtic?
Oh my god, what a question this is.
Okay, I've got an answer.
So have I.
You got an answer?
I don't know this, and I'm going to be fucking raging.
Right, you went first last time, so I'll go first this time. Yeah. I've gone for four.
You went for four. Please don't tell me you... Jesus Christ!
I went for four.
You went for four as well, Jesus!
We cannot be separated.
This is ridiculous.
We cannot be separated.
Absolutely ridiculous.
I've run out of sheets of paper to write on, I think.
I went four.
I can't believe this.
What was the answer?
Seven.
Seven?
Seven out of ten?
Yes, seven out of the ten have played for Celtic. Larson Griffiths, Scott McDonald, Anthony Stokes, Kenny Miller, Derek Rardon and John Hartson.
So
right.
We both went four.
Okay, right, let's try this one then.
Okay.
God almighty. How many points did Stennis Muir win the league with last season? There's a Stennis Muir question for you, Ewen. How many right. points did Steny win the league with last season? Closest two wins.
Right, I've got an answer. I was reading about this week.
Right, I've got an answer.
Right. it's you to reveal first.
Ewen, what were you for?
Please just give me up. I've had such a horrible weekend. I went for 81 points.
I've gone for 74 points.
Oh, no, we're going to have a winner. We're going to have a winner.
Where are you? One of yous is 6 points out.
Right.
And that person is... Stephen Mill.
Oh! Yes!
68 was the answer.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. That was amazing. Great to get over the line. I'd like to say hello to Ryan. I'd like to congratulate Stephen on his win on the quiz. You have the best wishes in the backing heading next week's quiz. Thank you very much. Matty, I actively support Stephen on every quiz. Derek as well. Thank you for your kind words. Hello to Russ. Hello to Cameron as well. Thanks for all your support when it comes to the quiz. It really does mean a lot to me. And thanks to my family, thanks to my friends as well, because honestly, the support that they give me is just unbelievable. But mostly to you, everyone who's watching and listening.
I am not going to give you the pleasure of me ranting and raving again, but can I just say that that quiz was fucking shambolic. And John, you need to get your act together, because that was all over the fucking place.
It was the same for everyone. It was the same for both of us.
I was on the hoof.
See you later,
I was on the hoof, Ewen.
Bye, Ewen.
Isn't it
bye, Ewen.
Get out
the door. Bye-bye. Nice doing a podcast with you. Bye. See you next week. There he goes, Ewen Cameron.
Cheated again.
So there he is. Ewen Cameron is away. I am still here because I won the quiz again, obviously. So thanks for all your comments this week, as per usual. Keep them coming in throughout the week. We'll read out the best ones next week. And is Cyriel Dessers underrated? That is the underrated overrated this week at Big Football Scott. And you can get in touch on YouTube as well. Leave your comments there. We'll be back next Monday for some more Big Scottish Football podcast action. It's been a great day. Hope you have a great week, and we'll catch you next time. Cheery bye.